Damn. That's how I was feeling today, huh? First Fat Joe song ever played. Ain't that some shit? You know they say, I don't want to talk about the taxes, because I don't want to talk about these taxes. They put me in jail for paying my taxes. I had to pay it twice. I need Donald Trump accountant ASAP. I need that man accountant now. Debating. Who knows what time is the debate tomorrow? If it's at 8 o'clock, I'm not coming on. Now, if it's at 9 o'clock, I'll come in at 8, talk our shit. Know what I'm saying? But tomorrow is the biggest day of all days. Tomorrow will decide who's president. That's how crucial tomorrow is. Tomorrow will decide who will be president. And bro, maybe it's because I had that tax issue in the past, but my accountants don't play. They make me pay for every single thing created. And man, I don't think I ever wrote off a haircut. I'm learning some shit. You can write off the haircut. You can write, my accountants fight with me. They can't write off clothes. They can't. But this guy's writing off everything. Like, I mean, I don't know. I think the fix is in. Ladies and gentlemen, one and only. One of my very good friends. Bam. Bam. Baklava. Yo.
My brother. Mr. Joey, how are you, sir?
Yeah, action, man. Let me tell you something, man. It's an honor to have you on here, but let me tell you something. You can't let no big boy lose no weight. Look at you. You topless on us, man.
Yeah, every single time someone sees me, I'm shirtless, man. I'm never wearing a shirt again. I'm only doing this so I can leave the house without a shirt. Straight up. I'll pick one up at the store if I need it.
Yo, man, let me tell you something. You know my brother Nori. He's the drink champ. He gets high on his supply. He's drunk every day. I was thinking about it. I said, how about Bam Bam? You in the gym losing weight, all this, and you got a cooking show.
I know, it's craziness.
So how are you gonna get high on your supply? What are you doing?
Well, the thing is, I did so much damage to myself, man, that I had to figure it out. So right now, I'm at a good place, and if I continue to do this, I can pretty much eat what I want. It just gotta be in moderation. So I'm, you know.
That's a fact, but let me ask you something. What made you? What was it? What was it that said, you know what? Because you was a part of the traditional, I don't give a fuck fat guy. You know, I don't care. I don't give a fuck. I got a beautiful wife. I'm making money. I don't care. Food is like my trophy. I love it. And then what made you say, I'm going to hit this gym?
Man, I was just uncomfortable in my own body, you know what I'm saying? Like, the movement, I didn't have the same movement as I used to. At 36 years old, I felt like I was 80, you know what I mean? Like, my bones, my knees, my back, everything was just not feeling well. And me being able to perform at a high level still was, it was crazy. And like you said, you know, we have our beautiful wives, you know, people still love us, we were fat. And it was almost like it was okay, you know what I mean? We made it okay to be fat. And, you know, we see people and we lose people and shit like that. And I just didn't want to be a victim. And I have a brand new baby. I have a brand new, like, outlook on life. I mean, I always was.
But maybe it was the brand new baby.
For sure. There's no doubt about that.
Because there's something always triggers you that makes you say, yo, I'm going to go look. Maybe it's the baby. You like, y'all want to be here for the baby.
For sure. 100%. It was all about that baby. You know, my girl, they were going to Colombia, you know, to go see the family. And it was like right before the pandemic hit. My dog was overweight, so my girl bought a scale. Straight up, just fucking, you know, I didn't have a scale in that long. So I got on the fucking scale. I was shocked, and I was 378 pounds. I couldn't believe it. You know, I've never reached that size in my life, and I felt
I was 470 the most ever, fat Joe.
It's crazy, man. But you wear better than me because you're taller than me. You know what I'm saying? Like, it was almost the same thing. It was like, you know, it was the same feeling, man. You know what I mean? Like, just, you know, I fucking feel like you're wearing a goddamn bed sheet all the time, carrying all that fucking, all that material on our clothes. How much material they had to fucking use. You know what I mean? Like, come on.
Were you always fat?
Not huge. I was husky. You know what I'm saying? Not huge, but being famous and fucking eating and traveling and just fucking being living
everybody
a certain lifestyle.
Everybody would have beat you at a dinner.
Exactly. Yo, that's what it is.
Let's go eat.
100%. Eat. Smoke. Fucking do nothing. Don't work out and just chill, drink, and hang out. That's
Yo, what's that? What's that like? Because the smoking, I see Ross has been able to keep it off and smoking. Ain't the smoking supposed to make you hungrier?
Yeah, I mean, listen, I don't smoke like everyone else smokes. I'm doing it a little healthier and a little bit more sophisticated, to be honest with you. I don't mean to sound like a cocksucker, but the hash that I'm smoking is the most pure form of it possible. So I'm blasting off more than I've ever done. You know what I mean? This opens my lungs. This opens my mind. It opens everything. So, you know, I'm not smoking blunts and shit like that. So there's there's none of that.
You know, Pun was skinny.
I saw the pictures.
Well, Pun was skinny and then he got big. So even when we played basketball when he was big, he used to spin on dudes and have a handle and all that. Nah, that's real talk.
That's crazy. I know it.
He was
playing
basketball like he was skinny. Like, you give Pun the ball. He, but what I'm saying to you is, you going hard in this gym. Like,
yeah, man.
And I'm watching you flipping tires and picking. Did you know you had this kind of strength? Or is it just showed up while you've been working out, building yourself up?
Man, I've literally been working out since I was 13 years old. I used to go to a gym on Northern Boulevard in Queens called Mount Olympus. Straight up juice head gym. I was 13 years old in there watching these guys, and I was fucking drinking metric shakes. I wanted to be like a power lifter, just a fucking strong person always. So,
also,
you know,
that's
that always...
So you've always liked that?
I've always liked that, but it never showed. You know what I'm saying? Like, I played high school football, always loved working out. But then I'm lazy. I'm lazy, man. I have it all in me. I have all this athletic prowess. I'm just fucking lazy. So now I've set my mind to never, ever be lazy again, because all the best things happen when I make moves, and I'm not fucking lazy. You know,
nah,
I watch
a
lot of, I get a lot of inspiration from around, like our boy CC Sabathia is the one who helped me out. He literally is the catalyst to put me into the situation that I'm in now. He brought
me to
the-
You know, he told me, you know, I'm in his house over the summer. He's like, yo, you better get Cock Diesel, because he said, ask for Boston, he going to be Cock Diesel. I said,
well, right.
CC, I've never been a Cock Diesel guy. I don't want no muscles. He was like, nah, but I think you and him should get Cock Diesel. I'm like, yo, CC, I'm cool with cardio. I'm cool working out. I feel good. My health is good. But he was like, yo, he warned me ahead of time. Before you was letting it go, like, you've been letting it go on the gram.
That's
but
right.
Ahead of time, he told me, yo, you better get down to this gym, because Ashton about to get Cock Diesel.
He's seen it, man. He's seen it in my eyes. I wasn't there to play, because he knows that we work with. He's not playing games. You know what I mean? Like, he doesn't have time to waste, and we just would be wasting our bread. You know, like, I'm not trying to waste time, money, or anything like that. So I get to it. And And it motivates you. Once you get going, you know, the hardest thing is to start. And once you get going, you fucking get on the roll. That shit becomes addictive. That's literally crack, man. You wake up every morning, you want to do it. You want to constantly work out. It's all talking about it, thinking about it. Like, if you ever watched Paul O'Neill back in the day in the outfield, remember how he would practice his swing in the outfield? Yeah. I'm like practicing my curls while I'm sitting here just figuring out different moves I want to do.
You know what it's called? Bro. It's like the bug. You caught it's that working out bug.
I got it. But
what do you feel?
I don't want it to just be like, you know, I don't want it to just be a for now. This got to be lifetime. This got to be a lifestyle.
Nah, it got to be action. You know what I'm saying? So the point is, you get
and
to
it's the
where
diet,
though.
You know that. You know it's the diet a lot.
Yeah, yeah. You got to get to where you at, and then you got to consistently stay where you at.
Absolutely.
You know, that's hard, too. So they don't understand. It's hard taking another human being off of you. So we take a whole human being off of us. So you took a whole human being off you, right? And now you did it. How do you keep this off for life?
Yeah, I just got to keep that same intensity every day, you know, like with the same way I go into it every single day with that mind frame that I, you know, I'm not there yet. Like literally I was 378 or 37, whatever it was. I always lie to myself, to be honest with you. Mm-hmm. I'm being honest with you. I lie to myself a lot. And then I stopped because I was doing that so fucking much. I was like, what am I, I had to take accountability. And I'm watching on some, like, I'm watching dudes like this dude, David Goggins. Like, you know, a lot of people draw inspiration from different things, but Joe Rogan, he had this dude on. He was a fatter dude. He became fucking Navy SEAL, this, that. He's like some next level dude, ultra marathons. It's just some next level shit. It's really about bringing the bitch out of you, you know, that inner bitch, taming that shit and fucking conquering over it and never letting your mind get weak. It's your mind. Your mind is literally the controller of everything.
That is a fact. That is a fact. So when you see somebody like Busta Rhymes just got in shape, he looking like he could be Busta Mr. America.
That's what I'm saying. Busta been massive. I saw Busta backstage at a Rock Marcy show. You know, beloved. He gave me the hand. He fucking engulfed me. You know what I'm saying? Like he's fucking massive. His traps, everything is, he's beastly.
Yeah, I'm not going to lie. I'm not scared of too many people. But if I'm walking down an alley and Busta Rhymes comes up behind me and it's dark.
Yeah, nah, man.
Yo,
yeah, that's
one day
that.
I'm sitting, I'm in Callan's house, and Busta walks in, and I knew it was Busta. And I was like, Jesus Christ, I don't ever want to fight this guy. Like,
oh, my God.
This guy's so fucking big, cocky. Busta Rhymes, he ain't, you know, because I meet a lot of cock diesel guys. CeCe's cock diesel now. Busta's like the scary. You don't want to fight this guy in the alley.
Nah, he know? Looks like he straight up looks like a defensive lineman or a line, like a line. He looks like LaVon Kirkland from the Steelers back in the day. He has that neck right now. You know, he's doing a lot of neck work. Bro. He's a very strong looking individual, and then the hand he engulfed it. You know, he engulfed my hand.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. He always been a man handler, man. He always like when he slapped you five, like now I don't.
Oh,
like,
he's that guy. He gives you the real strong five, right?
Like I do the slow, yo, Busta, salute you, General. Like I learned my, and then he be having a ring on or something. He'll be like, bah! That shit.
Oh, break your shit. Oh,
in your shit. Nah, yo.
Yo, you know the pounds that break your vein, man? Oh, man.
You know when they hit you dumb?
I know exactly what you're talking about. Come on. That's the worst. That and when a motherfucker has nails and they give you when they curl the pound up and then they scratch your shit.
That's a whole different subject.
That's fucking unbelievable.
Nah, that's disrespect.
That's not a possibility ever. Can't do that to a man. You can't do that to another human
being. That's disrespect. Back in the day, they would slap you five and cut you with their. That's bad.
Gotta start wearing the batting gloves, the Mizuno batting gloves.
You know, Busta Rhymes, man. Let me tell you, that boy, yo, I'm already professional. I've been doing this with Busta 20 something years. I'm like,
you guys
got
to dance. You do a dance, right?
I'm ahead of time, yo, Bust. Hold up. yo, Bars, my brother, yo, yo. And he already starts laughing. He knows, all right, let me not kill crack. So he be like, gonna give you like the, bah, Busta Rhymes. You be like, oh. For years. So it's, yo, you know what's crazy? I realized the other day, I told my wife, I said, yo, me and you both got Colombian wives.
That's true. That's true, man.
I didn't know your wife was Colombian. The other day you were talking about going to Colombia somewhere or something.
From Cali. Like,
huh?
She's from Cali, from Popayan.
Yeah, we from Pereira, baby.
Yeah, from Pereira. I know about Pereira also. Hell yeah. We were supposed to be out there, man. We were supposed to be out there in December also. I'm trying to spend New Year's out there. I hear it's crazy. The guarapo, all the craziness. Fucking get silly.
Yeah, yeah, yo, that shit. I went to Colombia one time. I'll tell you this crazy story, right? So I go to Colombia one time. I had like 3 shows. This dude paid me a bunch of money, you know, promoter. Go everything, everything top of the line. Everything top of the line, great. I show up to the show. It's my first show in Colombia ever. My family there. Every city we went to, the family was there like 20 deep. I show up, it's maybe 500 people and some shit that hold about 30,000 people.
Oh, right? My God.
Not real talk. So I perform. I don't know what else to do. I wish it was crowded. You know, I never like the promoter to lose their money. So I come back in the hotel, top of the line, everything. So I see the promoter there with all his workers, and they all look like scared to death, and they looking at me, and they this and that. So I walk over, I'm like, yo, papi, ¿qué pasa? So he said, ¿tú sabes lo que pasa? Ah, ¿tú quieres saber lo que pasa? Ah. Yo, so now, this dude turned into Scarface, my nigga. Yo, hey, yo, action. You're like, ¿tú sabes lo que pasa? De los pies, de la sierra. Te quiero con un bate con esto y reventar tu culo. Like, yo, this dude was telling me that he wanted to hang me upside down, stick a bat in my ass with nails in it,
holy
rip my
shit.
Insides, pull out my tusks. Not incredible. Like, the shit he was saying was out of this world. Straight Sosa Scarface, right?
Holy shit.
So when he finishes, I'm like, terminate, papi. So I told him, you finish? I said, papi, let me tell you something. After promoting, you should go write movie scripts for Hollywood. Because the shit you said, lo que tú me dijiste a mí, era increíble. What you just told me was the best shit I ever heard. Only problem is, I don't believe you and I'm not scared. Yo.
Holy shit. Yeah, yo, nah, that's the thing.
He looked at me like, huh? I said, I don't believe you and I'm not scared, bro. You better ask somebody. And yo, the craziest dude looked at me, he was like, uh-huh, this, that. Now, I'll tell you part B. Part B is the next day, we go to Medellin, right? We got another show, right? When we go to Medellin, so we got 4 cops, security. So when we go to Medellin, we going to see my friend that from Colombia, you know, a friend of mine. So we pull up. When we pull up, it's up in the mountain. When we pull up, the cops, it's like, yo, are you sure this is the address, Mr. Joe? I said, yeah, it's right up this hill, right up the mountain. They was like, oh, we can't go up there. You sure that's your friend? I said, I'm positive. They was like, oh, no, we'll wait down here. So we go up there. This dude got dancing horses, $1 million horses, horses in the pool. They making food for us. The pot is bigger than me.
Holy shit.
Man, we go there. We chill all day there. They literally, all bullshit. I posted it one time on my Instagram. The horse dancing in the living room. They got like sand and horses coming. They dance while you eat.
Yeah,
and
those horses like are wild.
Crazy shit.
Yeah.
But in any case, I go back to the hotel. The promoter's there. So the promoter goes, he says, oh, yeah, fuck, can I talk to you? I said, yeah. He said, did you go up to such and such's house up there? I said, oh, that's my brother. I seen him smash his cheek off. He loves me this, you know. I greet him like, he was like, oh my God. You know, tell me you know those guys on top of the mountain. I said, oh yeah. Don't think I don't know people in Colombia. Yo, that boy's whole attitude changed, bro. It was legendary. Let me tell you. But I had a great time in Colombia. Colombia, you know, it's part of my family. We Puerto Rican, yeah. Cuban, and Colombian.
It's different in the jungle, you know what I mean? It's just different in the jungle.
Let me tell you something, Bam Bam. So when you came up in the game, name me some influences when you came up in the game and how you got involved with hip-hop music.
I mean, you, Kool G Rap, Mobb Deep, Wu-Tang, fucking, you know, just literally, I used to buy tapes at Queen Center Mall. There used to be that spot called Tape World right there before you got into the fucking, to the food court, you know what I'm saying, right by the Sbarro's. Used to get any tape that was around, just buy whatever, the 99-cent singles, just buy the maxi singles, whatever I could find.
You was buying like mixtapes.
Mixtapes, Aqueduct Flea Market mixtapes, you know, when they used to have like the neon mixtape covers, these motherfuckers used to make their own shit. That.
You knew 50 Cent before he blew up off the mixtapes. Like, you knew,
yeah,
like...
absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, in Queens, that stuff is going around before everything, you know? Like, that shit was already around. Right on the Ave. You go to Ave, they had all that shit early, you know? Go to fucking Jamaican Flavors right across there. You got the fucking... The spot. All the mixtapes. We had a... There was a time where they put the fucking thing in the binder and you had to look through the binder for the mixtapes. The motherfuckers were stealing shit.
Remember, what's crazy is I was a fan of 50 Cent when he was in all the mixtapes and stretching Bobito. Even when he did How to Rob It, he dissed Pun when he was like, this guy fat. But Pun ain't like that.
Nah, right?
He like that.
Of course.
But in the mixtapes, it was real hip hop because you authentically heard who was up next.
Yep. Absolutely.
And who was coming. So I hear, right, Ghostface. Like when I hear you, when I first heard you, I was like, yo, this guy sounds like Ghostface. Do you know Ghostface? Was he like your main influence?
Nah, I know Ghostface, but I would never say that he's my main influence. I would say I'm more like Kool G Rap Cam. That's really my main influence. Kool G Rap Cam Pun type of thing. You know what I'm saying? It just so happens that we, you know, I guess we have a similar tonal voice, but I don't think that it's like that anymore. I don't think that it's been like that for a very long time. Maybe very earlier on in the game, but...
No, I'm talking about very early in the game.
Yeah, this has been 10 years. Yeah, it's been 10 years now, you know what I'm saying? So, I mean, I used to hear Ray, Nas, this, that, blah. But, you know, everyone tries to compare you to somebody. It is what it is. You know, you hear somebody, it is. I've been compared to you, you know what I'm saying? Like, it is what it is. Anybody, I don't think that there's one rapper or one person that hasn't gotten comparisons to another person. You could literally, there's somebody to compare everybody to if you really come down and fucking think about it. But for me, I of course, Ghost is an amazing rapper. He's one of my favorites. But I always try to, Kool G Rap Cam Pun. I don't know why, that's like, that twist.
You know, Kool G Rap, shout out Status Select. Kool G Rap, man, he was on my first album. He's somebody, you know, Pun, he was Pun's favorite rapper.
Yep, Pun, I know that.
Pun was him and Big Daddy Kane. Him and Big Daddy Kane. Pun always said he was a mixture of Big Daddy Kane and Kool G Rap. You know what I'm saying? Those were his two favorites.
like even Pun got compared to G-Rap at times, but you know, like at the end, you know, you just you continuously do your thing and you fucking carve your own shit. And
I think that's the way it is with everything.
That's what I mean. You have to continuously work at your shit, and you just gotta fucking show and prove and show exactly show the people who you are and what your personality is. And I'm totally a fucking 100% unique individual. There's nobody like me. I'm not like anybody else. So.
That's a fact, man, but we don't got to keep talking about this question because I just asked you simple. Don't worry about it, my brother. Everybody.
Because I was thinking about it. I was thinking about that because you're right. No, because you could fucking literally, you could, like, rap conversations are like that. You just fucking get passionate and intense. You could have these fucking conversations for hours and hours, and that's the beautiful thing.
Yeah, that was the good old music. I wonder if the kids are doing that to this day. So it's like when we was coming up, we would sit out in front of the building. I mean, at 6, 7 in the morning, my moms would be calling me out the window, and we'd be arguing about who's, like, you know, one of my biggest arguments was, damn, I don't want to diss nobody. It's okay, man. Fuck it. But, I would be bigging up Slick Rick, and then I would be mad at guys who sounded like Slick Rick. But there's some guys who sounded like Slick Rick that was popping off. So, you know, I'll be defending my favorite.
Like, who was sounding like Slick Rick? Are you talking about Dana Dane?
Dane.
Who was Slick Rick before him, or were they around the same time? Weren't they down with each other?
Slick Rick was definitely before him.
They were down with each other, right?
I don't know if they was down with each other.
Ah.
But I'm going to be honest with you. God bless Dane the Dane because he put in his work. But, you know, I would defend the Slick Rick issue. You know what I'm saying? Like, I would always be like, fuck that Slick Rick. And my brother Shy.
I love Slick Rick. Slick Rick's the guy. He's the one.
Yeah.
Slick
Shout
Rick
out to
is
my
the
brother
one.
Shy used to argue for Dana Dane. He'd be like, nah, Dana Dane's that dude. This, yeah. You know, just hip hop.
That's know, what I it wanna... is. You just always, you, there's always, there's different flavors for everybody, man. There's
Absolutely, different flavors but I'm wondering for everybody. If there's kids right now, like, yo, the Migos, and they arguing for hours, who's better, the Migos or, you know, Dom Kennedy or, yeah. My NBA court day, like, are they having these arguments?
Do you not think that today's music, that some of it you could just play it and it sounds like a fucking, like a 20, like a... At times?
Well, it always sounds similar. So what happens is, if you went back to Video Music Box and you seen...
Shouts to Uncle Ralph. I need that sweatshirt, bro. You know I hit him up, man. I've been asking for that sweatshirt since I seen him with it, like 2 years ago.
Yo, Bam, you got to buy it, though, man. I have my
daughter
purchase it.
I'm going to give it to him. I want to give him cash, though. I don't like using the internet. I don't like using the internet, man. I want to give it to him in his hand.
Yo, let me tell you something. I had my daughter cop it. I ain't even tell Ralph. And I was dying to wear it, man. And I wore it so fast. I was just like, he's one of the guys gave me my start, man. Video Music Box. So
it's a legendary man.
In Video Music Box, I was still in the streets, and I was hosting Video Music Box.
Well, I mean, you know how many of those things we have on VHS? I've seen those shits a million times.
Yeah, man, that was that. You know, Video Music Box definitely paved the way for everything that's going on now. I'm not sure if Ralph McDaniels and Video Music Box gets the credit they deserve. You know, but my point was, if you look back at Video Music Box, if you look at 1 year, so say Tretch. Tretch was like, so you can give me
fucking
bucks,
love
bucks,
Tretch.
Bucks, but,
I love, see, so, Tretch was the, he was not, was he not the father of a lot of styles, man? He was like the father of
this
a lot
is what
of motherfuckers
I'm
early on.
Shout out to Eric B. So Tretch is beyond nice. But what I'm saying is, even his hand movement, every other artist you've seen that year come after him, they start moving their hands like him. So hip hop has always been leaders and people trying to be like leaders. You get what I'm saying? Like, it's been a lot of follower shit.
Yeah. But you know what? With the whole follower shit and this and that, I just want people to understand this, that, you know, motherfuckers are fans of things. You know what I'm saying? Like, when you do something that's artistic and people love it and you're good at it, you're going to have fanatics of it and people who want to, you know, it's like Michael Jackson. How many fucking people dressed up like Michael Jackson to this day dance and make a fucking whole shtick about Michael Jackson and doing that?
Yo, let me tell you something. I'm glad you brought that up. Shout out,
you know what I mean?
My man Nigel, New York Giant. The other day I was watching his Instagram. It was one of his man's birthday, and they kept it like COVID friendly, but one of his mans, he had a Michael Jackson impersonator perform.
It's crazy.
And they was doing beat it all day. That shit. I love that shit. I was watching it on the gram. I was like, yo, this shit fly right here. I fuck with this shit, man.
It's unbelievable. To this day, you know, it's all flattery. At the end of the day, you know, it's generational, man. You guys pass the torch on to people, and, you know, shit doesn't last forever. And then new things are created from something. You know, there's always an idea, and then it all spins off, and there's more ideas and bigger ideas and different ideas and things that just...
What's the best? Your band.
That brings the fuck off all over the place.
Your band.
Talk
to me. Let me ask you something, being that you done been all over eating shit. What is the best three meals you ever tasted the shit and said, holy fucking Christ?
I mean, I don't think I've ever called Christ's name out.
Have you ever tasted something?
I might have called Allah's name. I might have asked Allah for forgiveness.
When you was like, Jesus, this shit is crazy. Like,
yeah, man. What? I mean, I'm thinking of one thing specifically right now in Paris at Bistro Paul Bear. It's the steak au poivre. It's a fucking piece of beautiful beef from Burgundy, which is France. And then it's smothered in like a black pepper cream sauce. It's fucking it's unbelievable. It's one of the
fucking love this shit, man.
Yeah, man, I want to fucking jump in it right now. I want to dive into the sauce literally right now.
Yo, man.
Man, yesterday I made some fire. I made some Turkish pizza called lahmacun. Lahmacun is just like, it's like very thin pizza dough and minced lamb with very delicious spices spread all over it. And then you bake it in the fire oven. It's fucking phenomenal. I made like 30 of them.
When I'm overseas and I'm on tour, I don't really, no disrespect, a lot of friends of mine, my taste buds are different than from overseas, other than Italy and maybe a little bit of Spain. So I always go to the Turkish shish kebab place every night.
Of course, that's just the most familiar thing in the world, right?
Yeah, yeah. Any country I go to, I go in there and get the shish, the gyro shit.
Donor.
Yeah, yeah, the straight donor. Up. And I'm good. No Diet Coke and some donut. I keep it moving. It's
that's
like
good money right there. That's protein.
I'm
going to
tell
packed.
You, I seen Nori just popped up laughing. Yo, listen, shout out my brother Nori. Yo, so listen, I'm going to tell you what's my meal.
CNN
I'm going to give you a meal.
A big influence. The War Report specifically is a massive influence on me. And the song Sometimes is one of my favorite songs ever. I ride around and I wanna crash, you know?
You know, my last one-on-one I ever had, a fight, I was driving to it, and out of all records, I played Nori's.
Get hype.
And it was crazy. I know they
said, did you have that playing during the fight?
No, it was hyping me up going, so.
All right.
I had to fight this guy, right? And the guy was on America's Most Wanted at the time. Mm. This is no bullshit. This is a fact. Like, the hood know. They know I ain't lying. The guy was literally on America's Most Wanted.
I knew
like,
a couple
on the
of
news,
them.
Like, looking for this guy.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I
like,
know.
Yeah,
I've
but
seen it.
So me and him had a problem, and then one of my best friends, my brother, said, yo, like, what are you doing, Joe? You Fat Joe the Rapper. I was Fat Joe the Rapper. I'm already Big Pun, Fat Joe, all that. But put Nori was what? So my man said, yo, listen, you shouldn't be, you know, it's going to turn into this. And he was like, let me try to see if you could fight this guy. The guy was cock diesel. But I tell you the truth, I thought I was going to lose the fight going over there. But I ain't care. So, but in the car ride, so he accepted the fight. And on a car ride over there, I was playing Nori's what? And I wasn't talking to nobody. I was in that zone, that pit bull, that, you know what I'm saying? Like, what?
I love
what,
it.
What? I was blasting it, and I pulled up, and you know, we had a fight one-on-one. And it's crazy, man, because, you know, when I pulled up, I seen a bunch of guys. You know, I'm from a foul place. You know, I seen a bunch of guys that always wanted to see me get my ass whipped, but never had the balls to step to me or try to move on me in the TS. So the TS was fully mad at me that I was going to give this guy an opportunity to fight me the one-on-one. It was like, are you crazy? Like, let's just go to war. Like, you ain't supposed to be. I was like, yo, look, it's going to prevent this turning into, you know, some guys you get beef with, you got to, it goes
there. It escalates.
Yeah, like you gotta kill them or they got to kill you. That's it.
Yeah.
So if you can find a way to figure it out in the middle and fight a guy, and most likely he's cock diesel, he thought he was going to beat me. They like, yo, fight him. Everybody who ever hated me was standing there, you know, watching. I'm not going to disrespect the guy because me and him kept the cordial, but I definitely won the fight 1,000,000% to the highest.
This level. Sounds like a Jean-Claude Van Damme movie.
Yes, it was.
Yo, the last time I had a
fight,
what's
the movie where homeboy was riding all around Brooklyn, killing everything?
Now, I don't know that movie, but I know that happened in real life, and that's the fuck. There was some kid on America's Most Wanted that was doing that. Some weirdo.
No, I'm talking about the guy. What's the guy that does the karate too? Not John Blanc-Claude. What's the Steven Seagal? Remember when
Steven Seagal?
He was in that movie where the other guy was killing everybody in Brooklyn.
Oh, fucking Bobby Lupa. Why'd Richie do Bobby? Yeah, Richie did Bobby.
What?
Yeah,
Richie? That's my movie.
William Forsythe.
Jesus Christ.
He's an animal. Yeah, man. He was in Blood In, Blood Out, too.
Yes.
Remember he was the Chicano?
Yes.
How did my man play a Mexican? That was wild. He's like the fucking Irish guy.
Let me tell you something. That boy's a hell of an actor, man.
It's fucking legendary shit. I was gonna tell you.
You know, so that you know, Nori, you know, he gets me hype. You know what I'm saying?
The last time I had a fight, I had matzo ball soup before the fight because the fucking kid was taking so goddamn long that I had to have a soup.
To calm you down, you just went in there and had a little soup on the way.
I just had a soup, and then I went in there, bobbed and weaved, and it wasn't even a good fight. I was disappointed at the end.
Oh,
I like a good fight, you know what I mean?
Well, you know me, the way I do it, I learned from my brother. My brother was no punk, and, you know, my brother would fight anybody, win or lose. And he would stand toe-to-toe with anybody, so I learned, like, it's like, if you got to go, you got to go.
That's
and,
it.
And just toe-to-toe, may the best man stay standing.
That's it. You shake hands afterwards and fucking walk off like a gentleman. That's it.
No, that's what I did with homeboy. Thank
that's
God.
That's it. Just, it's a gentleman's game. This is a gentleman's game. Don't get all fucking pussy and bitchy. You know, you just take your loss or you win, no matter what, you shake hands and keep it moving.
You know, I believe in that. And I've always believed in that. Everybody else don't believe in that when you give your hand and all that. But me, I believe in like, yo, it's over. It's over. Like, let's move on. You could have won, or I could have won, whatever the case may be. It's over.
That's it. That's it.
Move on. You know, some people like to harbor feelings.
It's true.
You know what I'm saying?
Well, that's, you know, that's an emotional trait. We got to get rid of that. We got to make sure that, you know, you release. You have to have release in your life. You got to let things go.
Oh, Bam Bam, I know this is a crazy question for you. Why should people go and vote?
I mean, listen, because I mean, fuck. I don't even know if anybody that we would be voting for is going to do anything. You know what I mean? I don't really know what the hell is going on. I know that the world is in shambles right now with who we have in office. And it seems like anybody would be better. You could fucking put anybody there. I would put Mike Tyson for fucking Jamie Foxx. You know what I'm saying?
Yo, like, but you would put Mike Tyson in there.
You know I would. You know I would. I fucking would love Mike Tyson to be the president. You kidding? Why not? At this point, why Mike Tyson can't be the president? If fucking Donald Trump is the president, who the fuck is he? I'd rather have Mike Tyson in there. You kidding me? He smokes DMT. He knows he has empathy on life. He knows about life. He's been through real struggle. You know what I mean? People like that know right and wrong, kind of.
Kind of. Yeah, you just got to hire the right people to put the plan in play.
Yeah, you need some help, some good help.
Bam, bam.
But always, you should always do, you should always vote. Vote for change. Vote for fucking, you know, make the right decision, though. Make the right decision.
Bam Bam, I did not tell you my experience. You did, you in Paris. Mine's is much more simple. I went to Puerto Rico, and my guy E. Philly took me to a truck after a club.
Oof.
No, listen, took me to a truck. It was a cheese line. Thank God they saw me, and it was like, oh, no. And you know me, I know how to skip a line. I
of walk course.
Right in the truck. It's like 4 in the morning. You know me, I start hugging dudes. You know,
absolutely. Hey,
I'm really trying to say, yo, give me a sandwich, miss. I'm out of here. And let me tell you something. They gave me a sandwich. Mommy, was you with, you was with me that time with that sandwich? She was with me. Bro, they gave me a sandwich on that truck that'll wake up the dead. When you talk about crack, cocaine, hitting the endorphins. I took one bite of this sandwich. Yo, Rich, I took a bite of this sandwich. That's just a bing. I was like, oh.
My
right
Lord.
In the parking lot, I was like, what the fuck is this? What the fuck? I couldn't believe it.
That, I'm telling you, man. Sometimes it'd be the simplest things. It's the simplest things, man.
A simple thing, but that thing, I don't even know what kind of sandwich. I got to ask E. Philly. What's the name of the truck? I think anybody who's been to Puerto Rico, they know the truck. It's in Isla Verde. I think it's steak, right? With onions and stuff. I don't know. That shit was crazy.
That's up my alley right away.
Have you ever ate a, even though we're talking about health and all that, but let's
fuck
get one
that.
More.
Fuck that.
Listen, have you ever ate a jibarito from Chicago? Jibarito.
From where?
So it's a sandwich, but it's made out of fried plantain.
Ooh.
And then the inside is the steak, onions, cheese, lettuce, tomato, mayo. But the
sounds
bun
ridiculous.
Is a fried.
That sounds ridiculous, man. That sounds ridiculous. I mean, we used to go to we used to play softball at Highland Park right there in East New York. And Papi used to come through with the shopping cart with the acapurias and all kinds of craziness. Like, he would fucking have the fryer right there and make it on the field. You know what I mean?
You know, my father used
and
to
the
sell.
And the kibbe?
You know, my father used to sell acapurias and what happened, Mike? My father used to sell acapurias in the park in the summer.
That's so what I'm saying. It's a special thing.
They had this man, he would come out my building, and he would go, I swear to God, he'd come out, we live in the project, 14 floors, he'd come out with a shopping cart. He lived in the second floor. So he would come out and go, Bastelillo, Bastelillo. When I tell you, from the front of my building he got to the point of where the sidewalk
sold out.
Everybody buy all the Bastelillos. He couldn't get around the corner to the block, nothing. The
yeah, man. See,
Bastelillo, Bastelillo. Everybody running downstairs to buy that shit.
Those are the real food. Those are the food stars right there, man. I'd rather eat shit like that any day than go to some fancy shit. You know what I mean? Like, I love going to Jackson Heights because they got everyone out on the street right now selling all kinds of different shit. So, I mean, that's my favorite thing: street food.
Let me ask
especially
you
Latin street food.
Jesus. Let me ask you a question, Bam Bam, and then I'll let you go. Your top five, dead or alive?
My Lord. It's so hard. It varies all the time. I'm just going to give my top. I just got to give one. It's got to be G-Rap. G-Rap, if there's anybody that I've listened to more in my life, I know his music front to back. Like, I could do a G-Rap concert for sure. I could go through his fuck. I could do everything. Every fucking syllable, every word. It was like, I love it. I love everything about it. I did a song with him. I didn't even put it out. It was kind of like just for me.
Wow.
I don't even know why. It's fucking heat. I killed it. He murdered it.
I've never done nothing like that. But I thought it was dope when they did the Wu-Tang album. Nobody ever heard it. They sold it for like $1 million or $2 million.
That's an interesting concept. All those things, yeah. There's a lot of people now that treat those like Nipsey when he put the album out, sold it for $100. Like things like that, you know, we do certain interesting things with this album to make it, because it's no longer in the hands of a label. This is art. You can charge what you want. You know, people exploit all kinds of things, man. The artists should be the ones getting the money.
That's a fact, because when you look at art, when we look at graffiti art,
100%.
It's crazy because now I see the artists that get the most money off of art are only imitating the art that was the legendary pieces that were on the trains.
Yep.
So when I look at art now, they got the Campbell noodles cans. These are all legendary whole cans and graffiti that now new artists are like putting on like canvases and all that, selling them for hundreds of thousands. But yeah, they only really recycled art from the trains.
Yeah. Well, and there's a lot of those old graffiti artists that are making money doing that, though. You know, it's not gone. Just like, yeah, there's like the older heads that are, you know, that have transitioned into the art world where they literally put their graffiti art on canvases and there's a platform make some bread, you know?
Well, I'm trying to tell you, just like with any other business, the guys who are making the most money never hit a train in their life.
Man, of course. These are guys, the fucking trailblazers, they never get the credit. It's always the fucking ones that come by.
The pioneers never get the credit, B.
It's true.
They never do. And it's crazy because...
But you got, you know, there's people, you got to fucking stand up for those people, man. You got to, you know, pioneers, there's history to everything. And, you know, you got to respect it and you got to know it. You know, you can't... I don't get into anything blindly. If I'm into something, I'm into it. I go in deep. So I'm making sure I know from top to bottom what my history is.
Yeah, shout out to Tats Crew, my people. And for sure. And they've been bio, doing this bio for Tats forever.
Is one of my favorite. I always love that throwy, the bio throwy.
Bio, yeah. BG, Nicer, Mac. My favorite graffiti writer of all time was named Shame 125th. Mm. I got the piece with him one time. He's down with Tats too. But he was my favorite of all time, bro. I used to wait to see his trains come by. You know what I'm saying? I used to love to see
a lot of amazing Bronx graffiti writers, man. The Bronx had some fire.
It was. Shout out to Kate Slade, Desi Dez. Yo,
there's
my brother,
a dude baby. Out right now. Hold on. There's a dude out right now from the Bronx that got it on lock. Straight up. This dude, TD. If you know about graffiti and you look at the streets, I mean, he's fucking literally...
Yeah, but TD been around forever.
That's what I'm saying. But 2020, he got fucking... He's all city again. He got the shit on lock. It's fucking unbelievable.
He's all city again, TD?
It's pretty unbelievable, man. Driving around.
Yeah, that corona, nobody was outside. He killed
the
city.
Now it's a wrap. Everyone's back out, man. Fucking, we missed that window.
We missed that window. Shout out to Jaws, Easy. Shout out to Coke 2. I got to give him that shout out because he's been doing it forever. Just all the graffiti kings out there, man. You know, I'm going to do a show. Crew,
FTR, TCN.
I'm going to do a show out here, all graffiti writers. It might be not be the number one rated, but it'll be the real shit that people will learn because people don't know that subculture, that graffiti culture.
Man, that's what you talk about, the elements of hip-hop. That's one of them.
Yeah, that's – oh, yeah.
Like, do motherfuckers even talk about the elements of hip-hop anymore? Is that even a thing?
That's our
era. That shit went bye-bye, right?
Yeah, you know, shout out to Crazy Legs is just on here. Rock
see,
Steady
like, shit like that.
Break dancing is one of the elements.
Unbelievable.
Graffiti, one of the elements.
Yeah.
DJing, MCing.
Yeah.
You know, but that's how it is. Yo, Bam Bam, we love you, brother. Thank
Much
you for
love,
coming
bro.
Up on here.
You're the man.
Nothing but love, my brother. You stay
I can't
up,
wait
man.
To see you. Let's go. Let's get this money.
Maybe, when I come back to New York, I could buy a muscle. Yo, I never had
you.
A muscle in my life.
You about to have a lot of them, man. Let's go. Come to the gym.
Know what I'm saying? I got it. I need a muscle. I've
you're going
to
have...
Everybody,
you're going to be fucking so muscular. No buying muscles. You're going
to
work
them.
Listen,
no disrespect to the ladies out there getting their waist done and their asses and all that. Listen, if Fat Joe could buy a cock diesel body kit, I would buy it tomorrow and walk in this motherfucking cock diesel chest out like, yo, it's good, y'all.
Oh, man.
It's crack, baby.
You back at it, man. You the man. Thank you, bro.
One love, my brother.
Be
stay
safe.
Up.
Peace.
Man, bam, bam. Woo! You don't know who I know. You know, Bam Bam. I said, you don't know who I know. Bam Bam reminds me a lot like me, right? Because he's just a cool, down-to-earth, having a fun time, dude. Every time I talk to him, it's nothing but fun times, great times. Man, what a good guy, man. What a good guy, man. And I've been watching his journey. He lost a lot of weight. He's out there getting cock diesel. I salute him so much, man, for being a beautiful guy, man. You know, I love Bam Bam. I love his music. You know, I got a song with him called Your Honor. Came out maybe 5 years ago or something like that. That's really, really dope. Primo did that. But Bronson, he's the real deal, man. I fuck with him, man. I fuck with him for real. Tomorrow night, I don't know if y'all know what time is the debate, but... what time is the debate? If it's at 8 o'clock, I might come on at 7 with a bunch of politicians and shit discussing, you know, a baby CNN. Or if it's at 8 o'clock, like if it's on time, I might just watch the debate. I just need you all to know that according to tomorrow, we will know who the president of the United States is gonna be. Register to vote if you haven't registered to vote. But I'm letting you know. I'm letting you know right now. Tomorrow's the most important day because all we want to know is if Joe Biden in the past, when he was younger, he was with the shits, like, you know, he's always been tough. But, you know, Trump, he been manhandling everybody. And all those past debates. Now we got to know the debate theory is to know if Biden is going to hold his own. Now, if Biden comes out tomorrow with the shits, then it's on. Well, the mayor's saying is at 9 o'clock. I gotta believe him. You know, I'm going with Biden, so y'all can waste all your Trumps. Y'all want on this motherfucker. Y'all know I'm a Democrat. I'm Biden. None of these politicians are perfect. Let's be clear on that. Y'all know what it is with me. I'ma stick to it. You know? Went out this week, went to a restaurant. I got real nervous because out in Miami, they let go the whole code. So, like, you know how the waiters got the mask? It got to serve you with the mask. It's everybody, nobody had mask on. And it was almost like I was wrong to wear a mask. And I don't know if I've been brainwashed or, you know, I don't feel comfortable being around people who don't wear the mask. I just can't get into it. And I don't know, it's just me. You know what I'm saying? So I don't know what to tell you. Like, you know, I just feel, you know, I got to get back into normal life. I've been in the crib so much. I've been quarantined so much. I've been home so much that I just don't feel comfortable. And you guys are letting all these Trump supporters come on here and go Trump. You guys is, where's the Biden? Where's the Biden in the comments? Yeah, I might be brainwashed. I don't know. But I know 200,000 people died. That's the problem. So when, you know, my friends who feel like, you know, the COVID ain't real, the COVID ain't there, but 200,000 families, somebody has died. I like Biden. I like Biden. Me, I like Biden. I've been like Biden. I've always liked Joe Biden for years. For years. This ain't new. Gotta remember when Barack Obama came out of Chicago and he wasn't the favorite and he wasn't the talk of the town. Joe Biden, who was the senator for many, many years, co-signed him, stood by his side. You know, that wasn't popular at first. See, in life, it has nothing to do with politics. In life, nobody likes to see the struggles. They always like to see the finished product. Okay, I'll see you tomorrow. Let's say 7 p.m. I usually come on at 8. I'll see you at 7 p.m. And I think I'll get some, I'll reach out to some politicians. Big ones. You know, I'm gonna try to get some big time politicians on here to tell us what we should expect in this debate. I'll see you tomorrow. Bye bye. Put God first. You know, I never leave with put God first. Should I come on tomorrow? You want me to take the day off? Or you want to kill yourself, huh? Let me tell you something. My family, they're done with this shit, bro. This Fat Joe show, I'm doing it for the people. They don't want to hear this shit no more. They can't wait till Corona's over and Fat Joe can turn back into Fat Joe the rapper. They're like,
no, we're for the people, baby.
You for the people? You for the people? Shout out to the Tats crew. That is my crew. Armando, what's up? Yo, put God first. Keep the faith. See y'all tomorrow. Big, 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 biggest show in the game.